We really just need you to tap the mics and say, test, test.
Sets him straight.
I drink your milkshake. I drink it up.
Oh, I haven't had a milkshake for quite a while.
I don't remember when last. This is Aerial View on thehoundnyc.com. This is me, Chris T, on another Friday evening, right at 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Only 1 hour.
The 1 hour of my week I get to indulge myself, Keith Hartel. Do you know what I mean?
I know exactly what you mean.
I get to be in the here and the now, in the moment. You know what I mean? You know what I mean?
I smell what you're cooking.
Thank you. Keith Hartel is back with us on the program, and it's good to have you back. I don't know if you've been on in 2020, so this is a first for 2020. How's 2020 treating you so far?
Things have been okay for me personally, but I have certain trepidations about the way 2020 will be experienced. I believe it's going to be an emotional roller coaster. I expected to be a detached observer of.
Wasn't that a Rolling Stones album, by the way? Emotional roller coaster, or am I? I'm
emotional rescue. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But that.
Yeah, emotional rescue.
Really,
that's
not
it. Yes.
Know that.
Oh yeah, no. I knew that. I was funning you, as they used to say on Hee Haw. I was just funning you, Keith Hartel. So
Stones record, emotional roller coaster.
So 3 weeks in, it's January 24th. You've already been on an emotional roller coaster, as have I.
Yeah,
by the way.
Yeah. Because now I think something good could happen.
Something good? You mean it's all looking up from here?
No. I just mean it's possible.
It's possible.
I was more comfortable with like nothing good could happen, and then just watching it and just being like, you know what though, that's normal. And just rolling along with my thing and just feeling kind of a little bit above everyone. And instead, I feel there's a possibility something good could happen. And now I am in danger that I could be disappointed.
Well, it sounds like you're riding for a fall, Keith Hartel. Is that what you're saying? Or are you building yourself up for a letdown? Which one of those? Is it perhaps both? You're riding for a fall while building yourself up for a letdown?
It's the Charlie Brown, when he tries to kick the football that Lucy pulls away, that shit. I mean, but maybe
yes,
not. And that's maybe why I have this feeling. Maybe not. That's why it would be so painful if the football is pulled.
Well, I think I'm in the same place. Actually, I've had emotional roller coaster since the beginning of the year. Let's compare notes before we even get into the meat of the matter.
Yeah.
Or what should I say for vegans? Can we still say meat? Because there is fake meat. There's meat made of soy and...
I do not cater to vegans.
Satan. And
I won't speak their language. Joaquin Phoenix is awesome in The Joker, but like that I'm going to make all of the Golden Globes eat plant-based food.
Well, the rap on them too was that they flew in like tons of flowers and burnt tons of jet fuel while they were trying to be ecologically sensitive, sensitive. So they kind of shot themselves in the foot.
Yeah,
well, expression goes.
That's I guess probably would be derailing, but that Joaquin Phoenix in the Golden Globes with the vegan angle against Ricky Gervais keeping it real and telling Hollywood where it's at thing. That's a whole big thing. But
it is a whole big thing.
Did you watch the Globes?
I did. Okay. Yeah. And yeah, I remain a fan of Ricky Gervais.
Yeah.
I've met him. He's I think he's done IDs for this program. I swear to God, I talked him into doing some Aerial View IDs back in the day. I have no doubt. But, you know, that is one place that takes itself very seriously. Hollywood doesn't like to be, they pretend to like to be deflated, but they don't really like to be deflated.
Oh, no.
And they love to crawl up their own ass whenever they get the chance. That's why, you know, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood's going to win a lot of awards
and
this award season.
Rightfully so. But Joaquin, like, because what was funny about his speech was that he sounded like what Gervais said really affected him, and because he starts with like, no, I know we should try to do better, and even though I'm happy, like he was like too real, like not superficial, and it looked like he was freaking the audience out. He was the first guy that got played off with music, but he seemed disturbed how Ricky Gervais, you know, kind of just set this tone. It was like, we all know there's a lot of this hypocritical gesturing. And that Joaquin Phoenix had taken it in, and then by the time he was on stage, he's like, yeah, I mean, we're doing our best. I'm glad we have the vegan food, but no, we shouldn't fly the planes to Malibu. Why? And he meant it. Like, he was fully... He's still Arthur Fleck.
Yeah.
And that's why he's a genius.
He strikes me as a very sensitive soul, that guy. A very sensitive soul.
Yeah, to the level where they should have a new word for it.
They should figure out something new to call it. This is Aerial View on thehoundnyc.com, where every Sunday, 3 p.m. Eastern Time, you've got a new hound howl that takes place. And then crashing the party, Mark and Miriam at 5 p.m., the doo-wop chop shop of the air. And, you got those doo-wops on 78. That's all. That's all I want to know. Do you have those doo-wops on 78? Do you? I got those doo-wops. on 78? That's all I want to know. I should say that every time I walk into a record store, just to be like consistent. To a friend of mine used to, for a year, he took a picture in the same pose where he was sort of leaning to the side with his hand up.
Yeah.
So anything he stood in front of, it just looked like, you know, you just kept changing the backdrop, but he stayed the same. And it was quite disturbing, and I should do that. Every time I walk into a record store, you got those doo-wops on 78, do you? I would love those. Aerial View, Keith Hartel joining me, and we're comparing the beginning of the year, 2020.
Yes.
I was on an emotional roller coaster. This week I held a living creature in my arms, and it died in my arms. And it was really an affecting thing that happened, to remind you, as the Romans would say, memento mori. You know the famous story, whenever an emperor would return victorious to Rome after defeating some foe, they would have a slave walk alongside the emperor or sit alongside the emperor. And as the throngs were celebrating the emperor and screaming his name and blessing him because he was coming back with all of this booty, you know, all this treasure and prisoners that they were going to turn into slaves. And the slave would whisper, memento mori.
Oh, yes.
Memento mori. Remember, you'll die someday. Don't let this all go to your head because, you know, you're going to be worm food like the rest of us, you know.
Yeah.
It's tough. It's a tough lesson to learn and see in front of you. And we lost our gray tabby cat this week. I knew Violet for 15 years of her 17 years. I met her when she was a combative two-year-old. Mm-hmm. She would swat at me. I called her Violent. I started calling her Violent. And she eventually grew to love and respect me as I did her. And then these last few years have been tough because of the hyperthyroidism and the kidney disease and the white blood cell count and the whole thing. And she just got old really fast, like we're all going to do probably. And then she was having a hard time at the end.
Like we're all going to do probably.
Probably.
Most likely. You know, like if I'm looking at the trends, looking at the numbers, the wall is like 1,000 billion and oh, the wall.
Right. The wall keeps winning. By the wall, you mean what some people call the veil.
Well,
as well.
You hit the wall, man. You're going to hit the wall.
The wall is
wall's undefeated.
The wall is undefeated. It is. And it will never retire. That's the thing about the wall, too. The wall will always be there.
Oh, no, no.
No, no, no. You,
I'll go on
you know,
to some
the storyline
in
Years and Years, which I'm finally catching up with on HBO, although the storyline in that show, one of the characters wants is transhuman, says, I want to be uploaded to the cloud so I can live forever. You
right.
know, this bid for immortality, this singularity, this thing.
Yeah, the Kurzweil,
you know,
Ray Kurzweil stuff.
That guy. And then the person who invented satellite radio as well is one of those singularity people and is a transgender, as a matter of fact. And I wish I could remember her name, but she invented satellite radio, made a lot of money, retired to an island, and became a woman. So
That's very what Matrix Wachowski, like that's a mindset. It's a mindset because, like, you know, the Matrix, when you saw that, that was like for a lot of people on different levels, like either for me, that was one of like, yeah, all that singularity, like life is an illusion, but like it's really happening now. Gnosticism is true, but it's technological. It was all confirmed in the Matrix.
All confirmed. Every last bit of it confirmed in the Matrix. Keith Hartel is with me, and we're recounting our 2020s, and I was saying we lost our tabby cat, Violet, on Tuesday, and it was a very tough thing because I sat with Violet in this room, this quiet room, in the veterinarian's offices, and they set up this room where it's like away from the other rooms, and it's somber tones and soft surfaces, and you sit there, and you know, I cradled her in my arms and I looked at her and I just thought, you know, how do you say goodbye? How do you say goodbye? How do I say goodbye to you, Violet? I just kept thinking, you know, someone said to me, it's better to go too soon than to go too late. when it comes to a situation like this, they said, I know people who regret waiting too long. I don't know anybody who regretted doing it too soon.
I pulled
because,
the trigger on the euthanasia.
Yes.
Yeah.
I and Sweet Tea, I waited to speak to her because I didn't want to make that ultimate decision alone. You know, she had Violet when I met her, and remembers her as a little tiny kitten.
Yes.
And, you know, when you've been around something that long, it is tough. It's tough to say goodbye, but you have to let them go. At some point, you have to release, because then people can't go properly if you don't release them. I do believe in that. I don't believe in a lot of mystic, supernatural type things, but I do believe you have to release people. You have to give them the permission to go.
Yeah, all right. I'm with that.
Yeah.
All the way.
So, goodbye, Violet. So long. And a little later on, I have a song for her, but I want to get to something in the news, the Upside Down update portion of the program with Keith Hartel, because I told you this just before we went on the air, and I know we're not on the air. I still don't know what to say instead of on the air.
Just what say on the say? Air. Go. Just roll with that. Just
yeah, be because like... if you could sell soy protein as meat, I can call this on the air.
And it's still air. There's still air involved in like the. They hear it through the air. It comes out of the speaker. The air carries it to the ear.
You're right.
On the air.
Why didn't I think of it that way? You're absolutely right. Thank you for seeing it that way. Because that's totally, totally, totally true.
It's what I do, man.
Yeah, point out things. What would you call that? Pointing things out? I point things out. That's what I do.
I'm in the George Carlin tradition of observational. Did you ever notice? It really is always the air.
Did you ever notice? Have you ever noticed? Did you ever notice? This is Aerial View on thehoundnyc.com, and there's something in the news that I find fascinating as somebody who is into the way things sound and listening to things. They, Keith Hartel, have reproduced the larynx and vocal tract of a mummified Egyptian priest, 3,000 years old. So they printed, they CT scanned him, they shoved him in a CT scanner. And by the way, might I say, Egyptians, this mummy looks beautiful. This thing is well preserved.
Yeah, well, no one knows how they did the pyramids, right? I mean, they have
it. It was slave labor.
But still, no, even the logistics, though, like, did anyone, I mean, this might be, this might be leading to a tangent, but isn't there a thing where
might
no one ever really figured
better
out,
be.
No one figured out the logistics of how the pyramid was built, like, really convincingly yet?
I heard it was a system of pulleys and slave labor.
No, but
so
those
there
two
has
things,
to be the
then,
slave labor,
but
yes.
But then there would have had to have been so much of it. Like, did they know something we don't know now?
Yeah, you know what they knew?
Yes.
Slaves are expendable. We'll just go get more. We'll sack some other country or whatever we need to do, and we'll find more. We'll make more slaves. We could lose some slaves.
So you're saying quantity.
I'm saying, with pulleys, a system of pulleys, and slave labor, you could probably build almost anything.
Mm.
Slaves are expendable. That's what the Egyptians knew. I think most people knew that held slaves.
No,
right?
You're right. I mean, I've spent too much time entertaining the aliens made the pyramid.
Well,
so I both sides is
if you're
slaves
gonna,
versus aliens, and it's really
who was
it's
that
really
guy?
Not
was it
on.
Was it Eric von Däniken who wrote the books about how the aliens built the pyramids, and they also built God knows what else.
Yeah,
they built a lot of stuff.
Yes,
they just didn't stick around. They were like, we're gonna build some stuff, and then we'll go. Just to leave signs that we were here. That's all.
You know, if you're not open to that kind of thinking, I mean, just being open to it, you can't correctly enjoy Space Odyssey 2001. And then why even?
Why even? That's what I say. But this mummy, I say this mummy underwent a 3D scan, a very high tech thing, and it happened over lunch. Like this guy met this other guy, this one guy who was into. You know, the mechanics of breath and the way the throat and the larynx combine to make sounds along with the tongue. And he was 3D printing vocal tracks, and he was having lunch with this guy who said, by the way, I'm an anthropologist. Do you suppose you could do that with a mummy? Da, 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 da. And the audiologist guy was like, why, sure, I don't see why not. I guess if it was well-preserved, I could. And it's like, oh, they're well-preserved. The Egyptians, they were the original embalmers. They knew exactly what they were doing. So they shoved the mummy into the CT scan, right? My initials, by the way. It's like a Chris T scan is what they did. And this guy manages to figure out a 3D model. And here it is. Here it is, the printed. I'm showing it to Keith Hartel. I know you can't see it, radio audience, but I will put this on the social. I'll put it on the Facebook. How's that? And you can find that at facebook.com/callaerialview. By the way, the number here is 760-422-5528. 760-I-CALL-AV. My number is in Palm Springs, and I'm not. That should be a song.
Yeah, it really should. Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But I'm not. That's where my phone number is. It's in Palm Springs. So call 760-I-CALL-AV. I searched around for these things, and I finally found one. Let me see if it'll play here.
Hi, you're listening to Chris T on WFX.
Well, that's old. I got to edit that.
I applaud that.
Yeah.
Like, I was just like, I was in the moment thoroughly impressed.
Okay. Thank you.
Full on.
Especially because found one.
He's a hero. What he did during the Globes was heroic, I thought. I mean, just right on the money, exactly like some bringing everyone together shit, I thought.
Yeah. Well, it's good. I think it's good to, how they say it, afflict the comfortable and comfort the afflicted.
Yeah.
So
yes.
If you're going to be in the service of those two things, I'm okay with it. You know, I'm okay perfectly with him afflicting the comfortable. And he did make them very nervous and upset about a number of things, including their, you know, how many people watched Harvey Weinstein do what he did, right?
Including
raping Annabella Sciorra, she described it on the stand the other day, and she talked about how in 1993 and 1994 she started crossing paths with this guy.
Yeah.
And one night he shows up at her hotel room door and forces his way in her hotel room and throws her on a bed and uses his body weight to pin her down, and he forcibly rapes her. But then he manages to withdraw before the money shot. And he's very proud of this, and he tells her, "I have excellent timing." And I guess she must have remembered that, because it's kind of a horrifying thing, you know. And
I'll always remember it.
So they cross-examined her. How come you didn't go report it to anybody at the time? And she's like, I didn't really know what rape was. You know?
And I thought I was still in the movies.
That's a lot of what it is, right? I don't know. I mean, I don't want to say that about her.
I'm not saying about her. I'm saying it about the situation.
Yeah. The situation. Well, look, the casting couch was a well-known thing long before Harvey Weinstein.
Certainly.
And he just took it to a new level. You know, he took it to another level. But how many years had you been alive before you heard of this thing called the casting couch? And you know, so that, but it's now over. It's forget about it. It's done. We're on to a new era now. But they still, the people around Harvey Weinstein facilitated his sexual assaults and his rapes, and they covered him up in many cases, and they let him operate for many, many years. So Ricky Gervais was, I think, perfectly correct to point that out, to say not only him, but Jeffrey Epstein,
and he did it in a funny way.
Palled around with, yes. And
Most importantly.
Yes. Well, he's a comedian after all.
Yeah. So. But you know what's funny, though, too, is that I don't know exactly what the joke was, but when Seth MacFarlane hosted, I think, the Oscars, he made a Weinstein joke and it was more inside baseball back then, but it was based on, like, you know, an anecdote a friend had told him, but there was some kind of like Weinstein is a creep when Seth MacFarlane hosted that he did. And, you know, he was, of course, asked about it afterwards. It was like, yes, I had heard the stories and I was making that joke. I hate this guy. And, you know,
well, there you go. Thank you, Seth MacFarlane. But I bet he doesn't sound like a 3,000-year-old mummy. And we're going to listen to that right now. What do you say? You haven't heard this yet, right? You said,
no,
this will be new for you. Let me just tell you a little bit about this story. Again, this anthropologist and this scientist are having lunch, and they're discussing the 3D printing. The scientist is saying we're able to 3D print a larynx and a vocal tract. And the only thing they really can't do is the tongue. I know I said the tongue earlier, but they're still having a hard time figuring out. And the tongue, obviously, is very important in forming human speech. And so they 3D print. The anthropologist says, by the way, can you do a mummy? And this guy is like, I could do a mummy all day long. I'm sure I can do a mummy. Why not? If the mummy's well preserved. He said, we're back to the embalming fluid. And by the way, earlier I was showing Keith Hartel one of my prized collectibles, which is a bottle of embalming fluid for children called Frigid Junior from the Frigid line. And formalin, which is a trade name for formaldehyde. So this bottle was full of formaldehyde. But what they did is they somehow, they put another ingredient in there that wouldn't explode baby's tiny veins when you tried to use this particular, you know, the full-grown adult version of this, frigid senior, I guess, or just frigid, I'm sure. So from Chicago, Illinois, featuring a baby that looks suspiciously like Warren G. Harding on the label. And so this is descended from the Egyptians. The Egyptians taught the art of embalming, right? They began the art of embalming. So any funeral director or mortician is descended from that line, you know, from the line of preserving human bodies as long as possible.
And you start to go into, like, who's the first guy that started thinking that was an important thing to figure out?
Well, I guess because the Egyptians believed that, you know, you were going to be sent off to the other world, but in with enough stuff and enough soldiers and enough money and enough loot. So they had to build the pyramids. They had to store these kings in there, right? And the mummified remains of these kings so they could pass over to wherever the hell they were going. But then they would make them 10,000 terracotta soldiers, and they would leave, you know, they would leave huge gold collections lying around of gold things and gold stuff, and all in an attempt to escape death, and it's not going to happen.
I believe, you know? So it sounds like the Egyptians invented materialism.
Well, you could go that far, and I would willingly go there as well. That's an interesting theory. I hadn't heard it put quite that way before, but I, you know, maybe this show is just a series of me and Keith Hartel signing off on things that each other say. And somebody called in. Let me see if we can call them back real fast, and let me figure out how to do it. Oh, here we go. If I press this, it's like, here we go. Let's see who called. I have my suspicions who it is, but we'll see.
You guys are hysterical.
Who the hell is this?
Phil in Portland.
Oh, Phil. It is Phil. I thought it was Phil. Phil, you know Keith Hartel? Have you talked to Keith before?
Hi, Keith. I've not spoken to you, but I've heard you. I appreciate your wisdom and insights.
Well, thank you, Phil. I appreciate that. I appreciate you.
Thank you.
Perfect circle of appreciation here. Might call it an appreciation society.
Phil? I'm going to walk upstairs to my phone booth.
What is this? It's like he's in space and he's telling us everything he's doing. Now I'm knocking on the door. Now I'm opening the door. Now I'm passing over the threshold. Now I'm inside.
Have you had any?
Now I'm closing the door.
Have you had any experience being funny, Chris?
Have you seen the new David Lynch 17-minute long short on Netflix where he interrogates a cappuccino monkey? But he rotoscopes in like someone else's lips, and it's all in black and white, so the monkey's talking with like a human mouth.
Dude.
It's very fucked up. I watched like 3 minutes of it. I was like, I can't handle this right now. I can't take the whole 17 minutes of David Lynch interviewing a monkey with a human mouth.
I wish I could smoke weed and watch that.
What is it called? Do you know, Phil? Is it called Jack? What did you do, or something like that? It's got some weird name.
I haven't heard of it.
What? You mean you're in Portland and you don't know?
No. Never mind.
It's called What Did Jack Do? What did I call
what
it? It's
Jack
called
do?
What Did Jack Do? And he interrogates a friend's monkey in What Did Jack Do? It's on Netflix now. So
is
that's
it a monkey or is it a chimp?
It is a monkey. I haven't said chimp once. I said monkey.
No, I know. But
several times.
Most people call all apes monkeys.
And that's really fucked up.
That's
and you know what? If we can elect Bernie Sanders,
yes,
people start taking that shit like not for granted and not just put it all lump all primates that are not human into one
right
fucking bullshit thing.
That's right. We're primates too, aren't we?
Yes.
Yeah, we're Homo sapiens.
We're the most overrated primates on the planet.
We're the ones that are going to destroy the planet. Are you kidding me? We're busy wiping out life as we know it and making sure that nothing can reproduce on the Earth's surface. It'll turn into a dying icy orb just hurtling through space.
We are here.
That's my prediction.
We're here to eat the sandwich, man.
That's Well, you are responsible because the boomers, you may qualify as a boomer.
No, I don't. Jesus Christ,
you dodged that fucking bullet because I'm a boomer.
68.
I'm a boomer.
68.
I'm a boomer and it's all my fault.
What's your year?
And
though?
I'm here to tell you.
What's your year?
62.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Because the
yeah.
64 is borderline.
That's right. 62. I'm responsible. I fucked all this up.
Yeah,
royal.
You're exactly like my dad.
That's right. You did nothing. I was in a punk rock band. I was singing songs about Ronald Reagan. What do you mean you did nothing? I did plenty.
But see, that's the thing. It's like if my dad from like whatever, 1940, whatever, and you are both boomers. Well, I'm going to start to just say that term might be not be like full on meaningful to me.
Yeah.
But
it's... When are these labels ever meaningful, Keith Hartel? That's what I want to know.
When you're using them for attack reasons.
But we're more than halfway through the show, and I haven't played this. Phil, do you mind if I play the sound of the mummy?
Hey, it's your show,
that
man.
They reproduced. Yeah, why am I asking for your permission? Right. So this guy who reproduced this vocal track of a mummy. By the way, the mummy's in the position he's lying in the sarcophagus. I get to say sarcophagus. So this guy, Howard, I think David Howard. He's the academic that they interviewed for this article. And he says, all right, well, we're going to put some air through this vocal track, this larynx, and we're going to record it, and we're going to see what this thing says. So that's what we're going to listen to now.
Chris, did you say larynx?
Is that what I said? What am I supposed to say? Yeah. Larynx?
Yeah,
Larynx.
What did I say?
Yeah, I said
larynx. That's a Dr. Seuss book, I believe.
Yeah,
the larynx. Yeah. All right. Are you guys ready?
Yeah.
Because let me get this lined up for you. Did you know it would sound like that?
The mummy is a
dick. It's just like Keith laughing.
Yeah. Say that again, Phil?
Sounds just like Keith laughing.
Oh,
I can't really hear what you're playing.
Yeah, that's okay. Listen, it was funny. You missed it. You'll have to listen to it later. I played Joe Biden. That's all.
Is that in the David? Is that also in the David Lynch movie?
No, this is my thing, the 3,000-year-old mummy. Wasn't that a Mel Brooks album with Carl Reiner?
2,000-year-old man.
I know.
I'm literal man. I'm answering your questions as asked.
Phil, how are things on the West Coast in Portland, by the way? Do you have this sense of, like, the impeachment trial going on? Are you sort of tuned out? No.
It's as big here as any place, yeah.
Definitely. Meaning it's not big at all. What are you saying exactly? Are people really caring, Keith Hartel? Does anyone care about the impeachment in Broglio?
Yeah.
What I want to know.
Yeah, it's a big deal.
In Portland, they care. Do you care?
I care in an abstract opposite. Like, this is making things that could turn out good be more likely to turn out bad kind of way I care. But,
But otherwise,
it is what it is. No,
man.
I don't care about, like, the, what the fuck is this fucking shit? Like, what's supposed to be what's the upshot? Like, what are we supposed to get from this?
It's going to go on his permanent record. Permanent.
Oh, that'll show him.
Yeah, you wait.
Yeah, I don't see that it's going to accomplish much, but it's the kind of thing where you have to do it. I mean, when someone breaks a law, if someone breaks in your house and you're like, I'm not going to get that stereo back anyway, I'm not going to call the police. I mean, aren't you going to report it?
This isn't like that, though. They didn't have to do it. I mean, you can make the argument that, I mean, they make the argument that they had to do it, but they didn't have to do it. A statement of actual literal fact. They did not have to do it. Now, if you say from a moral perspective, if you have this belief and that belief, and then these boxes are crossed off by the rules we've preconceived to be morally consistent, they had to do it. Okay. But there's a hysteria around Trump that is actually helps him and goes against things good. And that is why That's why I am afraid that I feel emotionally invested in that which I'd rather float above.
Ah, the floating above. Who's the boomer now? That's what I want to know.
I don't know. Someone born before 1964.
Yeah, I guess.
Anyone,
that would be
really.
Me. Again, it's me.
Yeah.
Sad trombone.
But how much does it matter whether you're emotionally invested? I mean, that doesn't seem like a big deal. I mean, it should be... The question should be whether or not to do it, and if it will accomplish anything.
It will accomplish nothing.
Well, I have to agree with Phil in that I do think that there are certain things that are so egregious, so unconstitutional, and so unignorable, if that's a word.
Like starting a war based on lies, which George W. Bush did, and people wanted to impeach him as a war criminal for making an illegal war based on lies.
And Obama and Nancy let Pelosi, him slide.
No, Nancy Pelosi literally let him slide. That's a matter of fucking record.
Well.
And that is why I say, fuck this, this guy doesn't act right, impeachment.
You don't want to engage in whataboutism either. Come on now.
No, whataboutism is a bullshit term.
Whataboutism
means you point out, like, oh, your thinking is not consistent, and then the other person is like, oh, but that's whataboutism, so it doesn't count. It's like, no, it's actually you don't really mean what you
mean.
Well,
all right, let me try this one. That ship has sailed. I mean, that ship has sailed. Does that mean that forever on we don't try to do the thing that is the right thing to do? Because this is the right thing to do, unfortunately. I mean, I know it doesn't really help. It won't ultimately help. It may hurt. But it is, I believe, the right thing to do because certain things, certain acts are so egregious that you, to ignore them is to be complicit.
Okay.
And so, you know, if they're saying we don't want to be complicit in this kind of thing and
here's
we're holding
your
you accountable.
Here's your answer.
Don't you wave your finger at me.
I'm waving my finger at the world because
okay, right.
I really mean this shit. The Soleimani was an assassination. That is fucking illegal. It's a war crime. Now, you have people like Mike Bloomberg saying it's outrageous that Bernie Sanders would call it an assassination. You have the whole fucking cable news system being like, you know, that I don't know if Trump did the right procedures, but everyone agrees that guy should be killed. An assassination, war crime, illegal war crime. There's controversy to call it an assassination. I say if you want to talk about should we impeach a president because he violated our international laws and assassinated a foreign leader, I would say, fucking yeah, let's not let it get out of control. But you know what? That ship has sailed.
That ship has sailed. Oh,
so I don't
that's...
give a fuck about, oh, he was trying to get them to say that Biden got his son an
well,
expensive
that's where,
job.
That's where you and I will have to part ways because I do feel like when you start jacking up the democratically elected leaders of foreign countries, jacking them up for $400 million, unless they do your dirty political work.
Wait, why are we giving them money?
I draw the line.
But why are we giving them the money?
Kind of behavior. We're giving them the money
to run it, to be part of our empire.
Well, to fend off the Russians is
yeah,
more
yeah.
like it. Yeah,
same thing. So. That's the same exact thing.
Fend off those nasty Russians.
And you know what? They actually are saying, and I believe it's come up in the impeachment.
Damn commies.
With the Russians. So we don't have to fight them here, really?
Yeah.
Your
really?
Commie has no regard for human life.
Yeah.
You bet your sweets, Mr. Commie.
Damn commies. Keith.
Hey.
Sparks were flying off the top of your head just now. It was great.
Oh.
It was great. You were like...
That's where it comes from, though, is because it's like everyone has been complacent, or at least like that's the way it is about our obscene fucking foreign policy that... Anyone from 80s hardcore got educated from the communist publication Maximum Rock and Roll about, like, you know, how fucked up, like, we, you know, war criminality through the entire Reagan era, which I would say would be more properly called the Bush era because it was George H.W. Bush, CIA foreign policy darkness that is dominated from then on. But Trump, he tried to get dirt on a political rival. Ooh.
Well,
it's that guy. And it's the fucking guy no one wants to win
the
nomination.
But see, you're only telling part of the story. Phil, tell him the part of the story he's not mentioning. It's not just digging up dirt on a political rival. What's the other part of that equation, Phil?
I lost track.
Well, he withheld congressionally mandated military aid and other
Phil's aid. Answer was right. Your answer is, oh, fine. But Phil's answer was the real answer. I mean, just by American, like the perception, the consciousness of the culture, Phil's answer was the fucking answer.
Well, thank you, Mr. Cynic. Mr. Cynic, thank you so much. Now, I do believe that this is egregious. It's an egregious affront to the Constitution, and something must be done. And I'm glad they're doing something about it, because it'll be a permanent stain on his record. A permanent stain!
And that'll show him. How's he going to deal with that?
I don't know. I think in another 30, 40 years, this whole thing will be done anyway. I don't even, you know, I think that we are running out of time rapidly. I think it's going to be one of those, you know, those Matryoshka doll effects. It's going to be one of those Russian nesting doll effects where, I don't know, things are just going to start to contain other things and transmogrify things until things get really, really bad. And suddenly we are an icy dead orb hurtling through space.
No, but Bernie, unless Bernie gets elected, makes an international deal to solve the environment and everyone has health care and lives forever because of Elon Musk and Bernie Sanders.
Ooh.
So, that's, and you know, but
really, is that what we're working on?
Well, what's the best thing I see could possibly happen?
All right. Well,
it's
that's
a long shot.
I called you Mr. Cynic. Maybe I should call you Mr.
All cynics Mr. are defeated Hopeful. Idealists.
I heard that. Phil, do you believe that as many times as you've heard it?
I'm sorry, do I believe what?
Phil, he's doing his taxes. That's what he's doing. Phil.
Me?
Yeah.
I'm working.
All right.
I'm working here.
I know, it's still early in Portland. It's only 3:42 in the afternoon in Portland. And here it's 6:42 in the evening, and Keith Hartel and I sit talking nicely here on thehoundnyc.com. Do you know what's going on here at thehoundnyc.com, Phil? Or do you have no clue?
When you say here, do you mean in your house?
No, I mean on the internet radio station known as thehoundnyc.com. Every Sunday at 3 p.m., it's a new hound howl. 3 p.m. Eastern time, all times Eastern. And at 5 p.m., crashing the party with Mark and Miriam, doo-wop chop shop of the year. That's what I meant, Phil.
Yeah, so okay. It's real. I mean, the hound is actually doing new shows, is what you're saying.
It is. It's real. It's true. Who would make that kind of shit up? Are you kidding me, Phil?
Even though most of what you hear is like 30 years old, right?
Well, there's a,
30? Like a lot of Nirvana?
Yeah, is it?
I don't know. Maybe. I don't know.
Like late Husker Du.
Yeah. Yes.
I think those shows go way back, don't they?
No, they go back like 100 years.
Yeah.
Every song is 100 years.
Thomas Edison recorded them through a goddamn phonograph. You're right. How did you know?
Wax cylinders.
That's right. They're on wax cylinders. Every week we have to play the wax cylinders. Yeah. It's really something.
Now, 30 years is like Soundgarden.
Soundgarden. Well, I would say, I think 1987 to 1984 is what I would say on the years. So that's a good stretch of time. That's 7 years, right? If my math is correct, my arithmetic.
84 to 87?
87 to 94.
Oh, that's 7 years.
Yeah. 7 years.
No, I totally agree with that.
Yeah, and that's hundreds of shows. So, you know, and what we like to do, like, for instance, right now it's January. We put up the January shows, right? And then in February, all the shows from February and so on. I feel like that at least keeps you somewhat in the feel of what was going on at that time of year. But it's interesting. It is like time travel in a way, and you hear about people. Sometimes I hear myself. I pop into the studio, and you hear me in the background, and I'm like, wow, that's weird. That's like 30 years ago, man.
It really is weird.
It really is weird.
You're just chugging, you're chugging along. You're listening to a show. You're getting into it, and they start talking about guys who have died 15 years ago or 20 years ago.
I like that whole effect. I do. There's something about it that's very interesting. And a lot of those shows I didn't hear when they originally were on. I don't know where I was or what I was doing. A lot of them I did, and I was there. But some of them I missed. And so it's good to hear them. But it's also good to hear Phil here, who picked up the phone and called all the way from Portland. And
you know what got me to want to call is your comments about veganism.
Okay. Or Keith's.
Mostly Keith.
Yeah, good. I managed to pass this off on you.
I just hope I mean, I've been a vegan / vegetarian for the past 28 years, and I just hope it doesn't, people aren't turned off as if it's just some trendy, self-righteous bullshit, you know. It really is a good thing.
No, I don't feel that way. I feel like vegans will outlive us all, and then maybe they'll eat us when there's no more food. Who knows?
I mean, to talk to you, Chris, a person who had your cat die in your arms, obviously you care about animals. And so my only point is, if we don't have to kill, don't do it. And obviously I'm healthy, I'm flourishing, and, you know, I don't need to eat animals to survive.
Oh, you're making me feel so terrible. I think I had a cheeseburger like last week. Now I feel horrible. I feel horrible. I do. I feel horrible. But Keith, correct me if I'm wrong. We raise those animals so that we can eat them, right? Otherwise, they wouldn't really exist. Cows and, you know, as many pigs as there are, we're sort of raising them as feedstock, aren't we?
Well, the way I would answer this is I would just say it's very similar to what people say, you know, let's assume I might be a guy that would be like in favor of Bernie Sanders. And there are stereotypes of like, well, you know, I like the idea of Bernie Sanders, but his supporters, they really are a turnoff. And so there's stereotypes about the way that like a certain kind of brand of veganism. When I was remarking about like Joaquin Phoenix talking at the Golden Globes, I'm actually hats off to his like real feel of that. And the arguments for veganism, both ethical and environmental, strong. And the idea that people should even just understand you're supposed to eat plants, even if you do also eat meat, it's all good. Like, yeah, it's all in the right direction.
I think that what Keith is trying to say, Phil, is that you are better than us.
Yeah.
And you've proven it by your clean lifestyle. I've seen your Facebook pictures. Phil is in excellent shape. For a man in his 70s, he's doing beautifully, and he looks fantastic.
Is he older, Mike?
I don't know. How old are you, Phil?
56.
56. He's a year younger than we are, and he looks like he's 20 years younger than we are.
He sounds like he's in his mid-30s.
Really? You have young voice,
and he probably doesn't have a gray beard, I guess.
Yeah. Can you talk more like this? Can you be more like...
Even though I live in Portland, I have no beard. No, I would love to give veganism the credit, but the fact is that I have really good genes. Although I am in better shape than my siblings, I think. So.
Keith and I are both horribly, you know. I would say I'm more horribly sort of not vegan is the way I would
Chris, go. I'd like to respond to what you said about the animals being raised for food.
Yes.
I mean, I don't know if that's an excuse. I mean,
I don't think we would have cows if we didn't eat cows.
It still has feelings.
It does, and I feel terrible about that, and that's the part where you have me, and admittedly, I would say you have me because I can't really put up any kind of defense. I mean, there's no real defense to that.
May I pose Phil a conundrum?
Yes, please. I love these.
Because this is a thing. I threw this out on Facebook, and only one side of the debate got angry.
And by the way, can I connect to you on Facebook?
I never go on Facebook. I might come back, though, now that I'm hanging out on Aerial View. I might have to hype it.
But, sure.
You can connect me. Okay. Like, yeah, I mean, I'll accept.
Wait, you're not my hype man? What happened?
I was trying to work on it, but what I said was...
Okay,
like,
go ahead. I'm sorry.
Like a pro-life abortionism, that issue, and veganism, same moral like conundrum, equal, and it's like it tends
Wait,
to
if
fall.
If you're a vegan, you should be pro-life. If you're being consistent, is that what you're saying?
I'm not. Well, I'm just saying. Well, each side tends to judge. Like a lot of vegans are very flagrantly pro-choice, and then a lot of pro-choice people are like, vegans don't kill animals. What are you, you know, what's your primitive thinking? And I just think it's the same thing where it's a personal decision about what the meaning of it is and whether it's, you know, what the ethics are. And it's a personal choice, and then it's a personal choice for yourself, and then going on to whether you think you should interfere with anyone.
Phil, before we run out of road in 10 minutes, too, I have heard carnivores defended this way. People say, well, you know, we evolved to become carnivores. That's what we are.
Well, that is true.
And we eat animals, and we draw the line at some animals. We only eat certain animals, but other animals we don't eat.
Those
animals are feedstock. We raise them so that we can eat them. Chickens and pigs and cows and that's, you know, feedstock. So we're going to raise them and we're going to eat them. Yes, they have feelings and thoughts and they're a living creature. And dear God, it's horrible. And that's where he gets me. Because I, what do you say after that? Sure, Phil.
They say, well, it sucks for them, but my shit ain't that great. Like, I'm going to die too.
And I'm going to feed the worms, right? As we said earlier, but, become worm food.
But, I mean,
yes.
But still, the ethical, like, I mean, just that in the sense that it's a personal decision, veganism and pro-lifeism, to me, are on the same plane. And I'm for pro-choice on both, technically, I guess.
But Phil doesn't strike me as the kind of person who would, if you sat there eating duck, if Phil would, like, visibly blanch or otherwise be like, ew, you know, you're disgusting.
The actual question is, does he see, do you, Phil, see that as a similar moral, like, personal choice quandary?
I don't know. I'm not sure it's a quandary. Let me just say that I am against abortion.
Oh, okay. That's why it's not a quandary for you. You're consistent.
Yeah. Yeah.
I did not know that. Well, there you go. Well,
that is not. See, that's like that. Every guy that's vegan should be hit, Phil.
Really? But if you're being consistent, Keith Hartel, is that what you're saying?
Well, if you're gonna make this, because like there's health and environmental arguments for veganism that have nothing to do with whether you care that you killed an animal,
right?
That are strong.
Well, yeah, so, there is the methane. Yeah, the goddamn methane.
Yeah. So the thing is, if you go on the whole like I don't want to kill animals thing. Yeah, I don't want to kill, like, you know, babies just before they get born should be also part of
your trip. No one's killing them just before they're born. Oh, my God. They're like a goddamn zygote. You know, I mean, we're talking about
Ralph Northam, blackfacer from North Virginia.
Oh, my God.
Wants to take the fetuses out, revive them, and then kill them.
No,
I look it up on the internet.
All right, well, we're almost out of road. Thank you, Phil, for the...
And this is why it's good you're not really on the air.
Hey, Phil, have you seen Cats, the movie?
That is my number one movie not to see this year.
I want to see it, kind of. You and me, Keith, come on.
Oh, dude, do edibles.
The thing is, you get fucked up and you go see Cats. De rigueur, as they say.
Yeah, no, it's
in
the
New York.
This is the new Rocky Horror.
It's, Phil, it's de rigueur. Did you know that?
I don't know what that means. No, what does that mean?
It means it's all the rage. You know, the French. It's all the rage, Phil. You go and you eat your edibles, and then you go see Cats the movie.
Well, I actually posted the picture of the Cats poster on Facebook, and 9 out of 10 people responded that they absolutely wouldn't want to see it.
Well, it is becoming ironic, see, though. That's the thing that Keith is saying, is that now people are going to see it ironically, because now it's ironic, I guess.
Well,
hey, now is that what you're saying?
There was a trend. There was some dude that was like a comic book writer on Twitter that wrote like how he took up mushrooms and went to see Cats, and then I think Vulture interviewed him or something.
Yeah, and then, it's become a thing now. It's like now it's a thing to
and
do.
And apparently like it does reach that level of maximum what are we supposed to do with this ism.
It's achieved that level. So you and I, Keith, we're gonna go at some point.
Yeah, we will have edibles
and we'll see Cats. How much longer do you think it'll be? Do you think they'll keep it in the theaters for a while because now people are seeing it ironically? Maybe that's what will happen.
It'll be at midnight in Montclair, New Jersey.
Like I used to go see Song Remains the Same in Bethpage or wherever the hell it was, the old theater.
Rocky Horror.
That's right. Midnight. I saw Eraserhead at midnight with my sister Joni. I remember that still.
I envy you for having seen
she brought
that
her boyfriend.
One of the earliest midnight movies.
Yeah. She brought her boyfriend, and I remember we sat there, and afterwards she was like, what in the living hell did we just watch for the last hour and a half? And I think it really freaked her out. I think she was really honestly like disturbed by it. You know, the lady in the radiator and the thing under the bed.
No, it is disturbing.
It's deeply disturbing. Yeah, you're supposed to be disturbed by it.
Into it,
right.
It should be disturbing.
And Jack Nance is in it, right? Jack Nance.
He's Eraserhead. He's the haircut.
And he's the
David Lynch avatar.
Oh, it's one of my favorite.
And the David Lynch
ever.
Avatar always has some version of David Lynch hair. If it's Kyle MacLachlan, the same deal. Some kind of David Lynch hair. You know.
Oh my God, we're almost out of road. Can you believe where all the time has gone, Keith Hartel? I think we got like 5 minutes left in the program. Phil, thank you so much for the call. I do appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Say goodbye. And to Phil, all the way there out in Portland, Oregon. We got to hear from the other coast, the left coast. Some people say it's the best coast, the West Coast. I don't know. You know, in terms of climate change, it's really suffering right now.
It depends.
I could find a lot of fault with it. That's like a geological joke. Get it? Fault.
Yeah.
Fault with it. San Andreas, anybody? Crickets. Nothing but crickets. I swear to God. It's like... So in the last 5 minutes, I just wanted to say one other thing about badass pickup trucks. We were out on a drive today on Route 80, and I was saying to Keith Ortel, why is every pickup truck nowadays a badass pickup truck? They want to loom up behind you. Like if I have a sedan, a saloon, as some European automakers call them, right?
Yeah.
It's a four-door sedan, and when one of these things gets in my rearview mirror, suddenly all you see in the rearview mirror is like the Ford emblem backwards, or the Chevy bow tie, or the Ram. Ram was the first one to really make these tall grills and these really tall pickup trucks, and now they come up behind you and they're like 3 inches off your back bumper, and they're just there, and they're huge and they're massive. They're all crew cabs because nobody could just have two doors on a fucking pickup truck anymore. And they all have badass tires and they're lifted and they're like, yeah! They're like, America, fuck it! Fucking pickup truck! That's what I imagine is going on inside the cab every time one of those is hurtling down the highway. And, you know, and I just, I've always heard.
That's got to be like a stereotype, though.
It is. Because one of them pulls into the parking lot of the Acme, and the door opens, and this guy, like 5'4", gets out. And he's wearing like some sort of synthetic fur. I swear to God, I saw this one time. Like the Acme, the Smack Me, as I used to call it, is now closed. We're supposed to get a Lidl. Who the fuck knows even what Lidl means? I asked my wife, is that an acronym? Like L-I-D-L, or is it Little? Am I supposed to say Little? And it's like, Germans are going to sell me produce now. That's going to be great. Yeah, we have the finest, the Romania. Yeah. Ach, du lieber, wait till you see our vegetables. It's going to be great. But this guy gets out of this out of this goddamn Ford, like XLT, whatever it is. And he was 5'4" and wearing a synthetic fur. And I really thought, do you need that much truck, buddy?
You're a little man in a big vehicle.
Do you really need that much truck?
What are you, Oz?
What are you, Oz? Is exactly right. Thank you for being here yet again, Keith Hartel. And I'll turn it back over to Vintage Hound programs, and then on Sundays at 3 p.m., New Hound Howl, and then Crashing the Party at 5 p.m. Eastern Time. This one is going out to Violet, who is with the Angels now. Thank you, Violet, for many memorable years. We're going to miss you. We do miss you. It's the only song I know of written about a cat and one who dies, written by Brian May. This one going out to you as well, Keith Hartel, but mostly to Violet. TheHoundNYC.com.
She came without a farthing, a babe without a name. So much ado about nothing was what she tried to say. So much ado, my lover, so many games we played. Through every fleeted summer, through every precious day. All dead. All dead, all the dreams we had, and I wonder why I still live on. All dead, and alone I'm spared, my sweetheart instead. All dead, and gone, all dead.
This has been Cozy Bear and Fancy Bear here on Aerial View on thehoundnyc.com. Thanks again to Keith Hartel. Find me on Facebook, facebook.com/callarealview. I don't believe you're dead.